They who had no pity now ask for yours. They who had no mercy now ask for yours. They who had no tears now ask for yours. If you have tears to shed, weep not for them. Weep for their victims.
It's not too often that I watch a film that really makes me think, not necessarily about the film itself, but the world we live in. Richard Brooks' 1967 film, In Cold Blood, is one of the few that have, and in a strong way. Based on Truman Capote's book of the same name, published 2 years prior in 1965, the film follows the real-life robbery turned murder of the Clutter family in 1959 at the hands of Perry Edward Smith and Richard Dick Hickok. The film details the crime itself, the time the two spent running from authorities, and their time detained, leading to their subsequent executions. But above all of this, the film is about human nature, the psyche, and the duality of man, choosing to focus on Perry's role, not just within the crimes, but within himself. This film is already of high significance in that it is based on true events, but is given a whole new layer of meaning through the way the story is told, especially when considering its social, political, and historical context. The actual events of the crimes will never truly be known, and more than likely played out vastly differently in real life than the film details, but this is to be expected when the perpetrators are the only living witnesses. However, the significance doesn't just come from the events themselves, but the unique point of view the film creates as a means of social and political commentary, constructing a psychologically thrilling story about a chillingly complex protagonist. Upon its release in 1967, In Cold Blood received predominantly positive reviews and critical response, earning $13 million domestically and going on to be nominated for 4 Oscars, including Best Director and Screenplay Adaptation at the 40th Annual Academy Awards in 1968. Despite being relatively unknown today, the film has shown that these award nominations are well-founded, maintaining its intensity when viewed through contemporary eyes. Much of this intensity comes from the film's absolute dedication to portraying the honesty of these events. One example of this are the locations throughout the film. This bus terminal, this gas station, this store, all the real locations where these events unfolded. The film goes as far as using the same courthouse, many of the real onlookers, and even 7 of the same jurors that decided their fate in real life. Many of the actors were chosen to be remarkably similar in physical appearance to their real-life counterparts, including the 2 killers, the murdered family, and the detective that solved the crime. The uncanny resemblance adds a layer of unsettling authenticity to the film. To take this one step further, the murder itself was filmed in the actual Clutter family's household, paying close attention to the subtle details of the actual events. In favor of realism, the filmmakers also opted for a monochromatic black and white color scheme, despite the potential to film in color. This was also one of the stipulations that Truman Capote insisted on for the film adaptation of his book, in order to create a sense of realism. In Cold Blood's director of photography, Conrad L. Hall, commented that the use of black and white gave the film a heightened sense of truth without making things too lurid. This decision shares a similar stylistic design principle to many film noirs, which have traditionally been filmed in black and white throughout history as a means of conveying a sense of a stark and gritty realism. All these elements work together to create a chillingly authentic portrayal of a real-life crime drama that had never been seen before, nor to the same effect since.
A tiger head. What does it do? Make you feel tough.
That cop's badge. What does it do?
Make you feel honest?
Everybody's got a tattoo. Only you people call them clubs.
But what pushes In Cold Blood from a significant film to a momentous one are the characters, and in particular, the protagonist Perry Smith, portrayed by Robert Blake. The robbery-turned-murder of the Clutter family is the basis for the whole story, and yet we don't see it until closer to the end of the film, in a flashback sequence, where the events of the crime are portrayed and foreshadowed as heinous, monstrous acts performed out of pure hatred. The character development and eventual unfolding paint a different picture. Though we find out it was Perry who murdered all 4 members of the Clutter family, he is positioned as the more empathetic of the two, stopping for a hitchhiking boy and his elderly grandfather, and even preventing Dick from sexually abusing the daughter of the Clutter family. And this begs the question why Perry would then kill the Clutters. And the answer has no logical reasoning behind it, simply because of Perry's internal troubled nature, suffering from dark impulses in an almost PTSD-like manner.
Doesn't make sense. I mean, what happened? Or why? It had nothing to do with the Clutters. They never hurt me, they just happened to be there. I thought Mr. Clutter was a very nice gentleman. I thought so right up to the time I cut his throat.
The film stands out against others of its kind, and especially of its time, and this is because it concerns itself with authenticity over all else. It builds all the characters of the film to make the story resonate on a human level. We witness the development of the Clutter family just as we witness the development of Perry and Dick. They are given time to show us their strengths and flaws, so that when the moment comes towards the end of the film, their deaths are greater felt. The same can be said for the boy and his grandfather, witnessing a bonding experience between the four and reminding us that Perry and Dick are people too. And all the while this is happening, the film never feels dull. Despite very little physical action, the film is much more fast-paced than you may expect from such a film of the 1960s. The editing keeps the story constantly moving, usually cutting at high points of action, supported by the engaging writing throughout each scene. While this is a great film and could be discussed and analyzed scene by scene in great detail, what I really want to focus on for this video is the last 5 minutes of the film.
Anything you want to say?
Just that I hold no hard feelings. You're sending me to a better world than this ever was. Nice to see you.
These last few scenes really encapsulate the film's intentions as a whole and bring a sense of closure and punctuation to the film and its central ideas, predominantly through the character of Perry. The sequence in question is the execution of the two criminals and provides a greater insight into the psyche of Perry. As he stands by the window of his cell in shackles, he tells the Reverend stories of his father. The lighting outside the window perfectly hits the rain as to project the vivid imagery of tears running down Perry's face. Created through sheer accidents, the shot has become one of the film's most powerful and influential, perfectly embodying the complex duality of Perry. Having previously learnt of his empathetic nature, especially in direct comparison to Dick, this shot helps to demonstrate this idea to the audience through visualizing the lonely crying soul beneath Perry's surface. His communication with others throughout the film lacks clarity, often going misunderstood and misinterpreted, partly of his own doing and partly by simply being more complex than others care to understand. This is emphasized in this moment, demonstrating Perry's lack of control over his actions and revealing the truth about his inability to clearly express himself and that he is sorry. As Perry concludes his story, he tells the Reverend,
"I guess the only thing I'm gonna miss in this world is that poor old man and his hopeless dreams."
The act of the Reverend standing paints the other half of Perry's face in darkness.
"I'm glad you don't hate your father anymore."
Perfectly reflecting the words he is speaking, emphasizing his internal duality.
"I hate him, and I love him."
His dark, involuntary side, contrasted by his lonely, troubled side. This clarity comes only at the end of the film, moments before Perry is to be executed, as a means of allowing the audience to finally see fully from the perspective of the character they have been following, making the film's ending all the more impactful. The film immediately goes from an emotional scene of inner retribution for the audience to the sterile yet hostile environment of the prison's execution chamber, reflecting a negative subtextual layer upon the idea of capital punishment. This idea is emphasized as we immediately watch Dick's lifeless body cut free of the rope he has just been hanged on. In this scene, Jensen, the man writing the story of Dick's life, summarizes the film's social and political commentary.
"Coming? What for? What's it add up to anyway? Four innocent, two guilty people murdered. Three families broken. Newspapers have sold more papers. Politicians will make more speeches. Police and parole boards will get more blame. More laws will be passed. Everybody will pass the buck.
The choice of words in this dialogue is important, alluding to this negative commentary on capital punishment. Jensen clearly describes both the Clutter family and the two killers as being murdered, likening the actions of Dick and Perry to the very system that governs society. He explains the inevitable cycle of the system that brings no real positive change in society, only leaving more people to be murdered, both by people like Dick and Perry and the so-called justice of the system. Jensen continues.
And then, next month, next year, same thing will happen again.
Maybe this will help to stop it.
Never have.
These few words very clearly put forward the comment that capital punishment is both pointless and immoral. Perry is then brought into the gallows chamber where he too is to be executed. He has read his execution warrant as we look down on him in a newfound empathetic light.
Anything you want to say? Perry?
I think maybe I'd like to apologize, but who to?
His words echo in the minds of the audience, demonstrating the misunderstood nature of a man who cannot even understand himself. The empathy only grows as we watch Perry readied for his execution, in a confused state of fear, sweating profusely and incessantly chewing. He then looks to the hangman, but sees the face of his father, a single tear in his eyes. As Perry previously recounted his father saying,
"Look at me, boy. Take a good look, because I'm the last living thing you're ever going to see."
In this moment, Perry seems to finally find himself at peace with his father, giving him a nod before we again see him as he really is. The film also comments on the validity of religion in creating a statement about the immorality of capital punishment. As Jensen highlights in his narration earlier in the film,
"It took 4 hours to pick the jury. It took the state 3 days to present its case. It took the defense 1.5 hours. It took the jury 40 minutes to bring in the verdict."
And throughout this court hearing, what the film chooses to focus its attention on is religion in support of the case against Perry and Dick, with the prosecution utilizing the Bible as a means of argument.
Genesis 9, verse 12. "Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed."
This begs big questions about the validity of religion and how it is utilized in society. This is reflected upon again in the last scene of the film, where Perry's final words are used as a poignant question of capital punishment, mere moments before he is executed and the film ends.
"Is God in this place too?"
Using God in Perry's final words, especially in this context, provokes these kinds of thoughts for the audience in order to convey the director's message about the immorality of capital punishment, as illustrated by this very complex moral issue that is made difficult in its political framework. The director confronts the audience with this final image and with the prominent sound of Perry's heartbeat. The film demonstrates that Perry too was a living being that has now been slaughtered by the very people who have ruled the act of taking another being's life as wrongful. The image and sound linger in the minds of the audience and remind us that, just as his victims, Perry too has been murdered in cold blood.